Sir, as far as transfer of certain technologies and certain chemicals from India to Iraq is concerned, since these chemicals, say chlorine plant or chlorine itself, is not say prohibited chemical and it falls in Schedule 2 where the trade can always be had between the two state parties, and the transfer of technology if required, then the convention doesn't lay any ban on that. So, but if misuse of that technology in Iraq, and subsequently we feel that technology would be misused against any other state party by the ISIS, so that can only be, say, either if it is anticipated or if it really happens, then we can. But in my opinion, transferring a chlorine plant from India to, Iraq doesn't fall in the category of any kind of violation of the convention, sir.
There's a misunderstanding. Chlorine plant is not transferred by India. It is built on the material, sensitive and prohibited materials provided by India and used by India.
I am not in knowledge of that.
Maybe I can just add to that, I think the various reports of the UN Security Council and the inspection organization have pointed out to two cases of material breach by India in terms of transfer to Iraq in the build-up to the invasion of Iraq or the occupation of Iraq or whatever. And I think those would be very clearly, and then the companies were also sanctioned as well. So I think that's fairly clear. As far as whether these will be used on the Iran border or not, I think our chemical protection people and our vigilance that we have on the border, etc., I think that would they would be aware of that through, if that happened through various intelligence and other sources. And your last question was on whether the fact that India had this agreement with us in 92, but it was clear in 93 that they had not had been in violation of that. When they did declare themselves as a possessor state with the 1,144 tons of sulfur gas, yes, we did publicize it at that time. But I mean, there was really nobody, in a sense, they had joined the OPCW. Their obligation was to declare that amount, which they did, and then to destroy it, which took a number of years, but which they did as well. So they had not, that agreement with Pakistan was not with the OPCW, and therefore we couldn't really tell the OPCW they were in breach of that. Thank you.
I just have an inquiry to make from Osman Zaidar's speech, that we follow the chemicals and the list of the chemicals of Australian group, but we are not the member of the Australian group. This is my comment that you said. So what you say about it?
Well, I think we have publicly on a number of occasions declared that we are quite qualified and we would be keen to join all the four control regimes, and this includes the Australian group, and we have had interaction with the Australian group on a number of occasions recently and in the last few years when they've sent delegations out here.
Dr. Sadiq.
Thank you. My question is about the monitoring mechanisms. As we have deployed radiation detection photon monitors on border crossing places to detect any illicit movement of radioactive materials, is there any mechanism or any kind of arrangement to monitor illicit trafficking of chemicals, prohibited chemicals, and related to this, if there are no monitors, quota monitors available for this kind of checking, are there any possibilities of having a mobile lab which can be moved to any such place and to check and detect and verify the nature of the chemical?
Dr. Zafar, would you like to do that?
I hope people at the back can hear me. Right. And the question about Dr. Sarik asked a question about the monitoring mechanism on the border with regards to the chemical, although we have the radiation portal monitors and other handheld detection equipment for radioactive sources. But just to share with you, we also have handheld detection equipment for detecting different types of chemicals, which are deployed on the borders as well as on entry, selected entry exit point, because at the moment, let me admit that the number of pieces of those detection equipment is far less than the requirement. But we are making efforts to deploy more detection equipment. And here in Islamabad as well, there are different sort of detection at the airport. At least I saw it during our this Export Control, International Export Control Conference, where the foreign delegates were also taken to the air freight unit. And there were a lot of detection equipment for analyzing, detecting, identifying different chemicals, not only with customs, but private cargo handlers, and also with the anti-narcotic force. They also had those first defenders and other equipment which are used for detecting chemicals. On the mobile lab, well, that would be an ideal situation where you have mobile labs right close to the entry exit points or certain selected areas where advanced analysis of different suspicious materials could be carried out. But customs has its own lab, although they have their different labs at major stations, but a time would be there where mobile labs could one could see deployed at the right close to the entry exit points. Thank you.
I would just like to add some a few things. One is that Pakistan has already produced a lot of detection equipment, including portable detection equipment and detection equipment which is held by the individuals. And number two, the CPL has also been established as part of the main overall plan where you have referred to, deploying detection equipment at the entry points. And number three, the third step in this direction is that we are already in the process of manufacturing and building a mobile lab, at least one at a time, and we feel that if there is a requirement of moving a mobile lab to one of such places where a detection equipment already deployed detects, so the mobile lab can be moved. So we are in the process of manufacturing one, and we have already established a static lab. And the equipment, the portable equipment, we have well quite a lot, and some of it has also been given to the customs and other authorities also.
All right.
Okay. I'll take these two questions or comments. You'll be very specific, introduce yourself, and also point out that you addressing the question.
Thank you, sir. My name is Mohammad Arif. Sir, my question is to Honorable Brigadier Sir. Sir, in case of a chemical attack, what steps you can suppose taken for the safety of the armed and strategic forces and for the general public. And also, sir, in case of a chemical attack, what are the steps or does Pakistan has the capability to remove decontamination from the site where a chemical attack takes?
Let me take the second question as well, and then we get the video message.
My name is Rubinali, and I am PhD scholar, and my question is from Ambassador. What countermeasure is having Pakistan, and how much Pakistan is prepared against chemical weapon pre and post attack, and how much Pakistan pharmaceutical sector and public health sector is prepared against this?
As far as preparation to face or mitigate the effects of a chemical attack is concerned, we have various institutions all over the country, particularly with the armed forces, including Navy, Air Force, Army and Strategic Forces, and then is the one which has been say quite talk about here, that is Chem Bio Defense Directorate, which organizes such courses and exercises at various levels, I would say strategic levels, national levels and international levels, and all these people who are trained at national level, they are then deployed at various places, and if as per their plan, so they are also provided with the equipment which has been indigenously developed by Pakistan. So that is to face a challenge inspection, what preparation we are carrying out. We have developed equipment and we are conducting trainings, and we have designated certain forces for that response. So these three steps. Number two part of your question, that was what kind of resources we have for decontamination. We have almost, I would say, not the whole spectrum of decontamination equipment, but we have decontamination equipment for the individuals. We have it for the, say smaller equipment, and we have even developed certain pieces of decontamination system for the strategic assets as well. And then the most important places, the decontamination systems have been installed as part of the facility.
Thank you. I think your two questions are very good ones. They overlap to a large extent. I think I would just add to what the British Office has already said, that I would like to just broaden it a little bit to say that there are two levels of preparedness. One level of preparedness is specifically against, let's say, a chemical weapon or their use, or some incident or release, even could be release of gas by cities like chlorine gas, like in India, that's on a large scale. So one is the technical aspects of that, which people are in the training, have been trained, and we have certain resources, etc. And the other thing is that the general level, which is that if there is some kind of emergency or disaster, public sector thing, increasingly our agencies dealing with disaster relief, dealing with emergencies, which means the police, first responders and others, that is also has been geared up much more than it was in the past. So I think these are the two levels that we will deal with any such use, because there will be public apprehension, fallout, some people's houses. Thank you.
Thank you. It's time to make some closing remarks and close the session. I am very happily reminded that when the CWC was being negotiated and completed, that was the time I personally undertook a master's thesis to work on CWC, and was, I must acknowledge, was encouraged by my supervisor at that time, Dr. Salik, who just asked a question, and also the chairman of the department, Dr. Zabuchima, who just walked out. And today's session has actually refreshed me with lots of stuff that that was done. And I was told at that time it was rather ambitious to do something like this, which was happening at that time. It was evolving. But several of those lessons that we drew, including the silent attack that had just happened in Tokyo subway, came around in a very useful manner. Now, if you look at the CWC, please understand that it is the biggest success for disarmament, and it is the most intrusive inspection mechanism that any international treaty provides. And primarily the reasons are that it is tricky subject to matter. You try to close in all gaps, and the convention provides you the methodology for it. And hence the implementation then becomes extremely important. There are lessons that exist. Several references have been made. We know about Syria because it's right in our face. We tend to forget about Iran-Iraq war, where these weapons were used, but that was the major lesson that came around at that time. Are there challenges? Yes, there are. There are some issues of definition. For example, white phosphorus, is it a chemical weapon or not? There's a debate out there even now. There are issues related to the new technologies. What about the chemicals of biological origin? How do they blend and how can they be dealt? But the good story is that there are hundreds and thousands of routine inspections that have happened around the world, and they have found better implementation every time they go around. Pakistan is a good example. Several inspections that have taken place in the declared industries have all gone extremely well, and with the report from OPCW that shows. There has been no challenge inspection around the world anywhere, but since the convention allows mock inspection, there have been several trainings and awareness has gone up around the world. Is that enough? Of course not. It needs to go on, etc., etc. But these are the issues that comes up. It also raises new challenges. While the international humanitarian law covers the areas related to armed conflict, there are areas and/or issues that come up during peacetime. The more recent ones that have just been elaborated by the panelists perhaps fall in that category. It also raises newer questions, like Sunsbury would tend to point out, and the North Korean brothers case would also tend to point out, how does the border management, for example, happen? Were those chemicals produced right in that country, or were they brought in, and how? So there's questions that come up, and they also tend to advise the countries that are involved to remain vigilant, remain not be complacent, and enhance the levels of understanding, awareness, trainings, and actual implementation and handling of such incidents as they happen. It still remains a tricky subject, and as you heard, there are several areas in which the international community needs to remain vigilant, and OPCW has been doing this to quite an extent in several ways, and it needs to continue to do that. The ideas about managed access that the convention provides also allow states to ensure the confidentiality of the non-related aspects of their organizations and institutions. Several of those ideas are relevant. I can vouch that when I started researching, I was wondering if there was any awareness in Pakistan, and I realized the first seminar which was reported that happened about awareness about CWC happened in the year 2000. And it was, there was information on the web available to that. So we've come a long way in that, but remember that there are significant areas that need to need for international community to collaborate together and find the most prudent ways of managing this kind of a possibility of threat. With that, ladies and gentlemen, may I request you to join me in thanking this panel for treating this discussion.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chairperson Mr. Khalid Panori, for leading the first session of the seminar and the speakers. We will now move on to the second session of the seminar, and I would like to invite Mr. Zahir Kazmi to take his place in the chair on the dais. He will be chairing the second session.